The next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on priorities for Scotland. The First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the First Minister up to 15 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I welcome this opportunity to set out the approach I intend to take in leading the Scottish Government. I want to take forward measures that will help people and their families to get on in life and to enable the people of Scotland to live happier, healthier lives. One of the benefits of long service in this Parliament is that I have witnessed this Parliament when it is functioning at its very best. That happens when we work constructively together. At the beginning of my period as First Minister, let me make it clear to Parliament that I will work with any party that comes forward with ideas about how we can make our country a better place to live. A good idea is a good idea, and I make it clear to all parties and to all members of Parliament that the Government will engage positively in considering ideas from all sources. I may have been out of ministerial office for the last year, but I am no stranger to government. I therefore want to build on the record of the SNP Government over the last 17 years, which has changed Scotland for the better. Our task today is to look to the future. That future should be built on the foundations of working day in, day out for the people we serve. Since this Government took office, economic growth per head and productivity have been stronger in Scotland than in the United Kingdom. Scotland has had the best performing A&E core units in the UK for 9 years. NHS funding has more than doubled, and we have the highest number of GPs per head in the United Kingdom. On housing, since we were elected, Scotland has seen over 40% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than in England, and over 70% more than in Wales. When we took office, renewable technologies generated the equivalent of 20.2% of Scotland's gross electricity consumption. Since then, this has soared to an astonishing 113%. The number of schools in good or satisfactory condition has increased from just over 60% to more than 90%, and we're seeing record levels of literacy and numeracy at primary school level. Since we took office, the amount of free childcare available to parents has increased from 412.5 hours to 1140 hours, and we have extended that to eligible two-year-olds. Recorded crime has fallen by around 40% to one of its lowest levels in half a century. And this year, using our limited social security powers, measures like the Scottish Child Payment are helping to keep an estimated 100,000 children in Scotland out of relative poverty. I would be the first to accept that there are challenges to overcome for the Government, but a substantial discussion of how we take forward the agenda to improve the lives of people in Scotland must start with an acknowledgement of the improvements that have already been made. Presiding Officer, in setting out my approach to Government, I am acutely aware of the economic and fiscal realities that we face. If we are to make progress, I hope and believe that we can find consensus on this. And in that spirit of consensus, let me put on record my strong agreement with recent statements made by members of the Labour Party. Earlier this year, the Welsh Finance Minister, Rebecca Evans, described the decisions taken in this year's budget in Wales as, and I quote, "the starkest and most painful since devolution." I absolutely sympathise with that situation. There is a developing consensus on where responsibility for those funding decisions ultimately lies. In a broadcast interview on Sunday, the Shadow Health Secretary, Wes Streeting, was asked to explain the performance of the NHS in Wales, and he replied, and again I quote, "All roads do lead to Westminster, because even though this is devolved, decisions taken in Westminster have an impact on the NHS across the whole country." The comment from Wes Streeting demonstrates the source of the significant financial challenges that we face. The prolonged era of austerity delivered by the UK Government over the last 14 years is having a profound effect on the fiscal context in which we are operating. An additional factor that shapes the economic and fiscal context we have to navigate is Brexit. The National Institute for Economic and Social Research suggests that compared to EU membership, the UK economy was 2.5% smaller in 2023. On that basis, £69 billion could have been wiped from national income in 2023, which equates to £28 billion of tax revenue across the United Kingdom. So with the same level of borrowing and taxation, that means without Brexit, devolved spending power for vital public services such as the NHS could have been £1.6 billion higher than today. Now, I recognise it is the Scottish Government's responsibility to deliver public services in Scotland, and I recognise the importance of Parliament scrutinising our record and our plans. But as we wrestle with these challenges, I hope we will also see some recognition from across this chamber that the context within which we work is significantly affected by Westminster austerity and the damage of Brexit. In my view, there is a very simple answer to that challenge, and that is for Scotland to be able to chart her own course economically and to make the best decisions on our own terms. For me, that would involve rejoining the European Union as an independent country and making our own economic decisions. And making that argument will be at the heart of my government's agenda. Those opportunities and powers, however, are not at our disposal today. So we must take forward our priorities in the current economic and fiscal context. The Finance Secretary will update Parliament on our expectations of the financial position. But I can say to Parliament today that the cumulative effect of the high inflation that we have experienced, austerity and Brexit, is placing enormous financial pressure on the resources available to the Government and will have an effect on the priorities we can deliver. With that important context, today I will outline the four priorities that will guide my Government's decisions on policy and budget. The four priorities around which I will work to secure cross-party support for the good of the people of Scotland. My first priority is to eradicate child poverty. Not tackle, not reduce, but eradicate child poverty. This will be the single most important objective of my Government and my Cabinet, because child poverty stunts the progress of any nation and stands in the way of both social justice and economic growth. My Cabinet will do everything in our power, including listening to and working with members from across this chamber, to achieve our aim. The Scottish Child Payment is a significant step forward. It is one of the most impactful measures in the effort to eradicate child poverty. But I recognise we need to do more. Last week, I confirmed the opening of a £1.5 million fund to support councils in removing school meal debt from families across the country. This will help ensure that no child is penalised because their families struggled to pay for school meals during a cost-of-living crisis. The Government recognises that one of the most effective ways of tackling child poverty is by enabling parents and carers to enter sustainable employment. We will look to deliver further measures that will support families to enter the labour market through training and educational opportunities, through employability support, through access to childcare, and through access to other public services that can assist in this effort. The second of my priorities is to grow Scotland's economy. From tourism to finance and technology to food and drink exports, we will work to create growth, to create jobs and to maximise the huge economic opportunities that lie ahead. Scotland's creative industries are another vital contributor to the economic growth of the country. That's why we're growing investment in culture and screen by £100 million over the coming years, ensuring there are more opportunities to not only participate in the arts, but for Scotland to reap the economic rewards of the creativity of our nation. We will work with partners to remove obstacles to the delivery of economic opportunities in Scotland, and we will go all out to encourage investment in Scotland and the huge potential that we have here, including in renewable energy, where we can lead the world. We will strengthen the support for innovation that has been anchored by the investment in the Tech Scaler programme and the package of entrepreneurship measures that were set out by the Deputy First Minister on Monday. Partnership working will be key to help our businesses boost profitability and create jobs, which will in turn help our people live happier and healthier lives with higher living standards. The Government will also encourage close alignment between the work of our universities and business to maximise the economic possibilities from the outstanding research base in Scotland. In modern Scotland, it should not be a struggle to find fair work or to raise a family. So for me and for my government, eradicating child poverty and boosting economic growth go hand in hand. I'm pleased therefore to announce the next steps we are taking in our drive to eradicate child poverty. Over the next 2 years, we will invest £16 million to tackle poverty and help families by expanding access to childcare services with 6 early adopter community projects. This investment will support low-income families to enter and sustain employment, with funding targeted at those who are most at risk of living in poverty. This investment will enable us to work with local authorities and communities to better understand what it takes to design and deliver local childcare systems that support families with children from 9 months to the end of primary school. We are already delivering innovative school-age childcare services through our early adopter projects in Glasgow, Inverclyde, Clackmannanshire and Dundee, and families are already seeing the benefits of that. Today I am announcing that this new funding will be available to expand that work and to learn more about what childcare should look like for younger children, including in new communities in Fife and in Shetland. This will ensure children, parents and providers play an important role in designing childcare services that work for them. It will contribute to the eradication of child poverty and support economic growth by helping parents and carers move into or stay in work through access to affordable childcare. Growing the economy will also be achieved through the third of my key priorities, tackling the climate emergency, by investing in green energy and infrastructure. The threat posed by the climate emergency and the twin crises of climate change and biodiversity loss is real and present, but so is the opportunity to successfully reach net zero and beyond. The recent significant investments made by Sumitomo and Haventus are illustrations of the investments the Government is determined to attract to Scotland. We will align the capacity generated by our vibrant entrepreneurial nation with our world-leading academic and research institutions, our valuable natural resources and our businesses and communities in a shared agenda to deliver net zero. According to Office for National Statistics estimates, in 2022, Scotland's renewable energy sector generated £13 billion in turnover and supported over 25,000 full-time equivalent jobs across Scotland. Analysis shows that with the right support, the number of low-carbon energy production jobs is estimated to rise to 77,000 by 2050. And supply chain development statements forecast £25 billion of investment is possible across the supply chain from ScotWind projects alone. In a modern, prosperous Scotland, we must invest in tackling the climate emergency in a way that creates jobs and brings local businesses and communities with us on that journey. Eradicating child poverty, growing the economy and tackling the climate emergency all link together to support my fourth key priority to improve Scotland's public services, not as a cost, but as a vital investment in our future health, equality and prosperity. The Government will focus on supporting the National Health Service to recover from the significant disruption from COVID. We will work with our local authority partners through the Verity House Agreement across a range of policy areas, including to continue to improve educational performance and to deliver sustainable social care by reducing delayed discharge. We will work with partners to improve the efficiency of the criminal justice system to deliver better for victims, and we will engage constructively to expand housing supply to meet the needs of the population and tackle homelessness. I will set out how my Government and my Cabinet will take practical steps to deliver in these four areas of priority when I present my programme for Government before the summer recess. Cross-government work on my four priorities has been underway since I took office, and the actions my Cabinet will take to deliver on these priorities will be submitted to Parliament for debate before the summer recess. And the programme for Government will be central to a wider range of decision-making that will happen before the summer on key issues on energy, on oil and gas, on reform of the health service and on taxation. Action will be set out on each, tackling the challenges facing Scotland today. As set out to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, in June we will also publish the medium-term financial strategy alongside a revised tax strategy and infrastructure investment plan pipeline setting out the position on the public finances, which will contain critical information on the challenges we face in the public finances and the actions the Government is taking to address them. That timing ensures that our programme for government and our fiscal strategy are developed in lockstep with strategies and approaches aligned. But it also ensures we respect and give time to the vital role of the Scottish Fiscal Commission in delivering their fiscal forecasts. Quite simply, it is good governance. Presiding Officer, there are many strengths in our country today. We have a talented population, we have abundant natural resources, we have dedicated public servants working hard to support our communities. But we are also operating in a very challenging financial and economic context. It is in that reality that my government will offer leadership to the country and a willingness to work collaboratively in Parliament to chart a way forward. My government does not command a majority in this Parliament. We will only be able to tackle the challenges we face if we are able to win the support of others. On this first occasion, when I set out the priorities of my government, I set out my willingness to cooperate beyond the government with other parties to deliver for our people. I want my country to do well. I know that others in this chamber across all parties want Scotland to do well too. I offer to bring Parliament together on a shared agenda to make our country better. I invite Parliament to work with me on that journey.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 30 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. I would be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. John Swinney's statement today on the approach his government will take confirms he is the ultimate continuity candidate. And I have to say, looking at his backbenchers, they seem bored listening to more of the same. I've never seen such little... Well, they're interested in my speech. I bet the First Minister wishes they were interested in his. And instead of accepting the issues facing Scots after 17 years of the SNP being in government, he's defending the records of Salmond, Sturgeon and Youssef. So let's actually hear the truth about the SNP's record. The highest taxes in the UK and an economy that is lagging behind the rest of the country. One in seven Scots on an NHS waiting list. A&E performance at record lows. A housing emergency. Drug deaths the highest in Europe. Climate targets abandoned. Schools performing at record lows in international comparisons. Violent crime at its highest level in a decade. That is the truth of the SNP's time in government. The only person who seems to think the SNP have done a good job is John Swinney, the man who has been at the heart of the SNP's time in government for a decade and a half. This is not a fresh start. It's more of the same promises that the SNP will break again. But the First Minister has spoken about working across the chamber. And in that spirit, I do want to work with him if we can.
Do continue, Mr Ross.
I will. And I really hope some of the members will stop laughing when I speak about the bill. I know the First Minister has spoken about. But if he wants to work with parties, that reaction from the SNP doesn't help. But he said a good idea is a good idea. And I knew it was a good idea when frontline experts and people with lived experience of addiction came to me with a bill to enshrine in law the right to recovery. It's now been published for over a week. It's just 6 pages long. Will John Swinney tell us today if he will personally get behind that bill? And while it's commendable to set a goal of eradicating child poverty, this is coming from the man who, as the Education Secretary, was tasked with and failed to close the attainment gap completely. And of course, we have seen yet again today from the First Minister independence being a top priority. He said, and John Swinney's words were, he will put independence at the heart of his government. The public's priorities are ignored again in favour of the SNP's obsession with separating Scotland from the rest of the United Kingdom. when Scotland desperately needs a new approach to fix our public services, to create more jobs, John Swinney is offering more of the same. Finally, just a few days ago, John Swinney said this: "I will demand from my government more concrete actions and fewer strategy documents." What a damning indictment of this SNP government from the man who was at the very heart of it for so long. So, given John Swinney held senior positions in successive SNP governments, can John Swinney tell us what he thinks John Swinney got so badly wrong?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, despite the determined efforts by Douglas Ross to get me off the agenda I want to pursue, which is about building alignment and building cooperation in this Parliament, I will resist the temptation to go on to the ground that he wants me to go on. Because the...
We will hear from the First Minister without interruption.
I'm very happy to defend the record of the SNP government. I'm very happy. I set out in formidable detail.
First Minister, we have a great many members who would really appreciate an opportunity to put a question to the First Minister from across this chamber. I'd like us to be able to hear from as many members as possible. In order to do so, I'd be grateful if members could resist any temptation to intervene when they haven't been called to speak. First Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. I set out in formidable detail the record of the government. And Mr. Ross posed a question to me. He suggested that I was the only person that thought the SNP government had done a good job. I'm afraid Mr. Ross is wrong on that. Because in 2011, the people of Scotland thought this government had done a good job. They thought it again in 2016. And in 2021, the people of Scotland...
First Minister, I'm sorry. I am going to insist that we resist any temptation to contribute from our seats. First Minister.
And in 2021, the Scottish National Party achieved the highest number of constituency votes ever recorded for any party in the history of devolution. The people like the SNP government. Now, I accept, Presiding Officer, that my party's faced a tough time. I couldn't have been more open about that. But I'm going to use the next 2 years to make sure we are fit and well to win the next 2026 election for the people of Scotland and return this government. Now, Douglas Ross asked me about the Right to Recovery Bill. And I've looked at Mr. Ross's bill and I'm in the process of taking advice about it. I'm taking it deadly seriously. And I will look, along with the Drugs Minister, Christina McKelvey, at the contents of that bill to ensure that we consider all of its, the issues that it raises. I think I have to be open with Parliament that there are mixed opinions about Mr. Ross's bill. It doesn't command universal support within the community of stakeholders who are interested in what I know Mr. Ross is interested in, which is tackling the issue of drugs deaths. So I think if we're prepared to have that open discussion among stakeholders, I'm all for that discussion, and I'll meet with Mr. Ross to do exactly that, to explore these issues. On the attainment gap, at primary school level, the attainment gap is at its lowest level on record. So the work and investment we've made on closing the attainment gap is having its effect. And I'm determined to make sure that the government delivers on the commitments it's made to the people of Scotland. That's what I'm in office to do, and that's exactly what I'm going to turn my mind to.
Anna Sarwar.
President Officer, in the 3 years of this Parliament, we are on to our third First Minister and our third statement of priorities. And after 17 years, John Swinney should not pretend that this is day one of a new SNP government. He says we should acknowledge where progress has been made, but there is no acknowledgement of the mistakes that have been made or the failures that have got us to this point. The single biggest crisis facing this government is in our NHS, where over 820,000 of our fellow Scots are on an NHS waiting list. But all we got today was a passing reference to the need for a recovery. So when will we get the actual detail? because we need a government that is serious about renewing and reforming our NHS. That is, of course, about money, but it's also about structure, workforce planning and innovation, of which there is no vision and no plan from this government. John Swinney also expects, somehow now believing in economic growth is somehow a revelation. That used to be the basics of politics in Scotland and the UK, but we've had 3 years where a hostile environment has been created for business in Scotland, and we've had ministers in government who didn't even believe in economic growth. So we need more than just words, because a failure to grow Scotland's economy has meant income tax being used as a substitute for economic growth, meaning people pay more and get less as a result. Now, of course, we share the objective of the First Minister to end child poverty. Ending poverty is in Labour's DNA. But this government needs to look at the decisions it's making to challenge poverty on education, on housing, on skills and employability. And let's not forget, it was John Swinney who downgraded the results of working class kids in the pandemic and whose decisions have led to cuts to teachers and resources in their very classrooms. So where is the change of direction? Now, I accept there are challenges in the public finances. That makes ending incompetence, waste and financial mismanagement even more important. And that must mean that we're making sure we're getting value for money for every pound of taxpayers' money that is spent. So does this First Minister accept that requires him to change the approach he's taken in the last 17 years that has left every Scottish institution weaker than he found it? And finally, will this new approach also mean the end to government by gimmick and press release? This is the government that declared a drugs death emergency and drugs deaths have gone up. This is a government that declared a climate emergency and now wants to scrap the climate change targets. And this is a government that declared rightly a housing emergency but also cut the affordable housing budget. More of the same ain't going to cut it. People can see through 17 years of SNP failure. They want change. Is he up to delivering it?
First Minister.
I can see I'm going to have to work quite hard to cheer up Mr Sarwar in this Parliament. But I'm going to start. Oh, my backbenchers are really quite happy with where we are nowadays, believe you me. I'm very clear that my backbenchers are happy about where we are these days. Now, Mr Sarwar raises the issues in the National Health Service of money, structure and workforce planning. So let's just take each of those. On money, the government has, as I've rehearsed with Mr Sarwar last week, the government has allocated to the National Health Service the greatest amount of, the strongest settlement of any aspect of our public services, to such an extent that the National Health Service now occupies a greater proportion of the Scottish budget than when the government came to office. So those are undeniable statistics. Now, we can only allocate the money at our disposal. We'd have less money to allocate if we now followed the attitude of Mr Sarwar, who's changed his mind on tax. Because Mr Sarwar, now Mr Sarwar is, I think, is saying to me that's not true. I'm sorry, I've been listening carefully to Mr Sarwar and Mr Mara. Both of them have changed their stance on tax. They voted for the measures that this government put in place in the first place to ask higher earners to pay slightly more in taxation than they would if they lived in the rest of the United Kingdom, but they have now reversed their position on that. That means they can't ask me for more money for the health service because they would be cutting public expenditure and making less money available for the National Health Service. Now, on the question of the challenges in the public finances, Mr Sarwar, I thought Mr Sarwar would have come here with a different script, because I thought he would have listened carefully to what Wes Streeting said on the television on Sunday, because Mr Streeting told it the way it is. All roads do lead to Westminster, because even though this is devolved, decisions taken in Westminster have an effect on the NHS across the whole country. He was talking about Wales, the same issues apply in Scotland. It's Westminster that's the problem in all of this. And really, for Mr Sarwar to say to us that every Scottish institution is weaker than it was when we came to office. I ask him to take a look at Scotland today and to look at the strength in our universities, the strength in the public institutions of Scotland that are serving our country well. What he says is insulting to the public service of Scotland, and I won't entertain it.
I call Patrick Harvey.
The First Minister is right that addressing the climate emergency can be good for the economy, and if we get it right, it will protect people from high energy bills too. But he also knows that the same members of his own party who have spent years lobbying against climate action and for the oil and gas industry are still doing so. And after the events of recent weeks, they are emboldened. So will he have the courage that has been so clearly lacking in the past, the courage to face them down, refuse their demands, and commit to the radical acceleration of climate action that is so clearly needed, to cut road traffic, to decarbonise heat and more, action that's necessary if Scotland is going to make up for so much lost ground over so many years?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I hope I've made clear to Parliament that climate action represents one of the four key priorities that will drive this government. And what I want to do is make sure that we take steps that will take people, that will engage people and businesses with us on that journey, because we must do it with people. We have to take people with us. Now, just before I came to Parliament this afternoon, I met with the First Minister's Environmental Council, a group of experts who are providing advice and input into the government's thinking on net zero, and discussed the very issues that Mr Harvey raises with me about the importance of effective and urgent action to tackle the climate crisis. And those discussions will be reflected in the plans that are brought to Parliament in due course by the government, which will be in accordance with the targets and the aspirations that we have to achieve net zero in the timescale that we've set out.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm in politics to get things done, to do right by my constituents and try to change our country for the better. That's why I want to see the First Minister tackle the issues that matter to the people that sent us here. So can I ask the First Minister, does he recognise that those same people want change and need a government that will get the basics right on education standards and the violence in our classrooms, on access to a GP at the first time of asking, and a dentist near you that still offers NHS care, on missed climate targets, on sewage dumping in our rivers, on the ferries fiasco, and on the 175,000 Scots suffering long COVID that this government seems to have forgotten all about? And will he recognise that Scotland has had enough of the worn-out divisions of the past?
First Minister.
President Officer, I've made clear to Parliament in all that I've done over the last few weeks that I think the need for there to be collaboration across the parliamentary chamber is absolutely essential for what lies ahead. It's not only essential, it's a necessity for a government that doesn't have a majority. But let's be absolutely crystal clear that this government has got to change the way in which it interacts with Parliament. That's a fact of life for it now. So I will be very happy to engage with all parties, as I've made clear, in addressing the issues that face our country. I'm in politics to get things done. I want to make sure that Scotland is a better country as a consequence of the activities of government. I'm sure that's an aspiration that Mr Cole-Hamilton shares as well. And you know, there will be issues. You know, there'll be answers I can give him to the points he's raised about education standards, where, as I've said already, the attainment gap is closing is at its lowest level with primary pupils, that the attainment in primary levels is at its highest than it's ever been. So there is progress being made there. We can all acknowledge that. But what I'm certain about is that Parliament will have more of an effect on the public if we're able to work together in common cause, and I commit us to doing that.
Thank you. We have many members who would like to put a question to the First Minister. I would be grateful for concise questions and responses. And I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the First Minister's commitment to the eradication of child poverty, a task made difficult after 15 years of austerity begun under the last UK Labour government, which imposed cuts deeper and tougher than Margaret Thatcher. does agree that the best way to reduce child poverty is for parents to be in well-paid employment, and is growing the economy to provide high-quality employment amidst Brexit, UK economic incompetence and Scotland's budget being repeatedly cut will not be easy. Can they remind the Chamber what additional measures the Government will introduce to promote new start-ups, innovation and growth?
First Minister.
President, officer, the economic context that Mr Gibson sets out is part of the realism that we've got to face up to, that austerity is undermining the resources available to us and the resources we have available for our public services, hence the importance I attach to growing the economy to improve and expand the tax base. So the convener of the Finance and Public Administration Committee makes substantial points in that respect. On Monday, the Deputy First Minister announced a £5 million package of support for start-up companies. It takes forward the recommendations made by Mark Logan and Anna Stewart. It builds on the investments that have been made in the Tech Scaler programme, which the Deputy First Minister and I both saw in Barclays in Glasgow last Friday. So the support to ensure that we have a strong ecosystem that supports innovation is essential to encourage economic growth in our country.
Liam Kerr to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The legacy of when education was this government's priority and the now First Minister was Education Secretary is one of plummeting PISA scores, an attainment gap that remains stubbornly high, violence in schools, falling teacher numbers, and promise after promise on laptops, school meals, contact time and recruitment, broken and sometimes even abandoned. First Minister, how can the people of Scotland have any faith in this First Minister delivering the priorities he set out today, given that his delivery whilst Education Secretary was such an abject failure?
First Minister.
If we look at the performance of Scottish education today, there are record levels of literacy and numeracy attainment at primary school level and improvements in secondary. There's a record low attainment gap in literacy between the proportion of primary pupils from the most and the least deprived areas, achieving curriculum for excellence levels, and there are reductions at secondary level. Last summer, we had the highest ever number of passes at National 5 and a record number of vocational and technical qualifications that were achieved. In 22-23, 95.9% of school leavers were in a positive destination 3 months after the end of the school year, the highest level on record. Yeah. If that's the consequence of my stewardship of education, I'm pleased we're making the progress we're making.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, I welcome the offer from the First Minister to work cross-party, and I hope you'll be able to update the Chamber on the costed proposals they bring forward. Now, the First Minister's clearly set out the challenging financial agreement, climate, and the fact that all roads lead to Westminster. But will he agree to look again at using all of the ScotWind monies for day-to-day revenue, as I think he understands and appreciates the critical need for financial resilience, financial sustainability, something that seems to have been completely forgotten by Westminster?
First Minister.
I think that I understand exactly the point that Michelle Thompson puts to me. The government has got to make a careful set of decisions about the use of the resources that we have available to us. The ScotWind resources are resources that we have earmarked for long-term investment in the economy, although given the pressure on the public finances, and I've been absolutely candid with Parliament today about the intensity of those pressures, we face difficult choices in ensuring that we can deliver the services and the policies that we wish to deliver within the financial resources that we have available to us because of the persistence of austerity. Now, some of that could change if there was a change of government. By later on today, we might be having a general election announced, who knows what on earth is coming, and there may be some degree of change that comes in that respect, who knows. But what I can say to Michelle Thompson is the government will give consideration to all of these issues as we take forward the development of the medium-term fiscal strategy and then also the annual budget, which will be presented to Parliament later on this year.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by John Mason.
Presiding Officer, I have one thing to say to the First Minister, and that's bring it on. I am, however, disappointed that there was nothing specific to rescue the NHS from crisis. Health is devolved, and whilst I know it isn't just about the money, it's about what you do with it, let me give the First Minister some undeniable statistics. Because until the SNP came to power, Scotland spent 22% more on health per head than they did in England. Today, that gap is only 3%. That's as a result of decisions taken on the SNP's watch. And of course, this isn't year zero. John Swinney was the finance minister who failed to pass on money from the UK Labour government that would have seen the NHS £1 billion a year better off today. So does the First Minister believe that he should apologise to NHS staff and patients for the last 17 years of this SNP government, which has left the NHS weaker, not stronger?
First Minister.
I really don't know what Jackie Bailey's talking about the issues in relation to the Labour government. It might be so long ago that I might have become forgetful, but I gave a commitment. Jackie Bailey can write to me about it if she wishes, and I'll consider it, obviously. Jackie Bailey tells me she doesn't wish to. That's possibly because maybe the accusation doesn't
have... Let's hear the First Minister.
Perhaps the accusation doesn't have substance about it, and it might not make it into a letter in black and white. We've passed on the consequentials that have been available from governments in the UK to the health service in Scotland. And if there's any apologising to be done, I think Jackie Bailey should apologise for two things. One, that when the Labour executive was in power in this Parliament, they failed to spend £1.6 billion of public money. They left it in the Treasury and they incurred massive PFI costs that we are still having to pay in Scotland today. And secondly, Jackie Bailey should apologise for the crippling burden that PFI legacy is posing to local authorities and the Scottish Government, the length and breadth of our country.
John Mason, to be followed by Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you. As the First Minister said in his statement, Scotland's finances are still very dependent on Westminster, and I think Labour agree with that as well. He mentioned supporting the NHS and expanding the housing supply, but can he explain how we can make progress on these if Westminster keeps squeezing our budgets, and particularly our capital budgets?
First Minister.
The capital budget is a particular challenge because of the degree of erosion of the capital budget by two factors. One, the direct cuts that have been made by the UK government, which is of the order of 10% over future anticipated years. And secondly, about the corrosive effect of inflation, which in capital projects is even worse because construction inflation is invariably significantly higher than routine inflation within the economy. And some capital projects in the private sector, as I think I've rehearsed with Mr Mason before, are now coming in at perhaps 30 to 50% inflated on their original costs or expected costs. So there is a challenge there, which is obviously why we're having to wrestle with the contents of the infrastructure investment plan to ensure that we have a sustainable programme that will meet the expectations of the public in Scotland. There are, of course, additional sources of finance which we have to try to activate. And the Housing Minister, Paul McLennan, on specifically on the issue of housing, is trying to identify and to work with with a range of interested parties to try to expand the resources that are available for investment in housing.
Douglas Lumsden, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the last week, Unite the Union and OE UK have warned that the Scottish Government's presumption against oil and gas is threatening thousands of jobs, which will have a severe impact on our economy and block the economic growth that most people agree we need. His two predecessors refused to remove the presumption against new oil and gas. So will the First Minister take this opportunity to remove that presumption against oil and gas, or will it be more of the same?
First Minister.
As I set out in my statement, the Government will bring forward its proposals in the finalised energy strategy, and obviously that will be shared with Parliament in due course, and the issues that Mr Lumsden raises with me will be set out. Obviously, I want to engage constructively with the oil and gas sector. I was in Aberdeen on Friday and had very constructive discussions with a range of stakeholders, many of whom are involved in oil and gas. It's a very healthy and constructive discussion, and I welcome the contributions that were made. I will be discussing these issues in due course with Unite the Union. I'm keen to have that conversation, and will do so at the earliest opportunity.
Emma Roddick, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is important that our rural and island communities can see that this SNP government is the government that will work for them. Projects such as the new Stornoway Deep Water Terminal, backed with £33.7 million of Scottish Government funding, represent the latest chapter of this SNP Government's commitment to the prosperity of rural Scotland. Can the First Minister set out how the Highlands and Islands feature in his priorities for his Government?
First Minister.
President, sir, I'm glad that Emma Roddick made reference to the development of the Deep Water Terminal in Stornoway. It's already fulfilling its original purpose of providing a safe berth for cruise vessels who are bringing thousands and thousands of visitors into the Western Isles who would not previously have been able to access the Western Isles. So it's a really welcome economic boost. I was discussing this with the Stornoway Port Authority just on Friday when I was speaking on the economy, and I was pleased to hear the progress that that investment that was facilitated by the Scottish Government, and which the Scottish Government's invested in, is having such a strong and positive effect. In addition to that, of course, the Government has commitments to the regional growth deals, many of which affect the Highlands and Islands as well. And we will take forward the Islands programme, which has already distributed resources to a range of island communities. And I do hope I have the opportunity in the early course to travel to Scotland's islands to make clear the importance I attach to addressing the needs of every part of our country. And I'll do that as soon as the opportunity arises.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. You cannot tackle child poverty if you don't make education a priority. And can I say how disappointed I am to see that education does not appear in the First Minister's list of priorities today? Because right now in Scotland, education is in a perilous state. Despite the stats the First Minister chooses to quote, performance in PISA scores has dropped, teaching is a precarious career, more pupils are absent from school, and the situation facing pupils with ASN has been described as intolerable. Pupils, teachers, school staff and parents have been let down. When the First Minister was Education Secretary, he said closing the attainment gap was his priority. But the gap in secondary school is no better now than it was in 2016. He said fairness in assessment during COVID was a priority, but the exams fiasco downgraded the poorest pupils. And he once said maintaining teacher numbers would be a priority, but 450 are to be cut in Glasgow alone. So can I ask the First Minister, should the priorities he set out today be worried?
First Minister.
I'm not sure if Pam Duncan-Glancy picked up all of what I said in my statement, but I made it clear the importance the Government attaches to education as part of my priority around public services. The other point I'd make to Pam Duncan-Glancy, I obviously spent a lot of time, as I spent 5 years as Education Secretary, immersed in discussions with educationalists the length and breadth of the country. And one of the points that was made to me strongly was that the corrosive nature of poverty amongst children was the most significant factor that eroded educational performance and engagement. Yeah. So I'm not quite sure how Pam Duncan-Glancy doesn't accept the steps the government is taking through, for example, the Scottish Child Payment, yeah, which is one of the contributory factors to ensuring that 100,000 children in Scotland today are kept out of poverty, yeah, is not beneficial to our education system. That is an essential investment the government is, yeah, making. It doesn't happen in any other part of the United Kingdom, and it's a measure that's been described as the measure with the biggest impact, yeah, on reducing child poverty in, yeah, Europe in 40 years. Why can't we accept that we're on the right course to tackle child poverty and improve educational attainment?
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the First Minister's commitment to tackling child poverty. Just last week, the renowned right-wing Conservative Suella Braverman called for an end of the cruel two-child cap, something Keir Starmer has ruled out. Can the First Minister advise what difference to child poverty levels in Scotland could be achieved by removing the cap, and can he confirm that it will be a priority of this government to press the UK government to take action in this regard?
First Minister.
President Officer, the issue that Rona Mackay raises is very important because it does affect the amount of money that is going into low-income households that are living in poverty. It's a deadly serious issue with significant human consequences. That's why the child payment is so effective, because it puts money directly into the hands of families who are struggling. Now, the analysis which has been undertaken would suggest that should the two-child limit be lifted, around 10,000 children would be lifted out of poverty overnight. 10,000 children. Now, that's a deliberate policy decision of the United Kingdom government, and it appears to be a deliberate policy decision of the aspiring Labour government to maintain that two-child limit. Yep. It is absolutely indefensible because it is subjecting children in our country to poverty, and it should be removed right away.
Rachel Hamilton, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Presiding Officer, John Swinney was Finance Secretary and around the Cabinet table when the SNP wasted hundreds of millions of pounds of taxpayers' money during the CAP farm payment scandal. He was the Deputy First Minister who negotiated the Green Deal that was a disaster on so many fronts for rural Scotland. And today, as First Minister, he talks about growing Scotland's economy but has failed to acknowledge the vital role of farmers and producers in his statement. When will the First Minister recognise the importance of farmers, crofters and land managers? And will he commit to publishing a draft rural support plan before stage three of the Agricultural Bill?
First Minister.
I represent a diverse parliamentary constituency, some of which includes part of the great city of Perth, but the overwhelming majority of it is country area in rural Perthshire. So I understand and am very closely connected with the farming community that I've represented for over a quarter of a century. And what the farming community say to me is they've been absolutely hung out to dry by the Tories over Brexit, and I'll never let them forget that.
Yeah. Ruth Maguire, to be followed by Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While Scotland leads the UK in affordable and social housing provision, support with housing costs and grant funding for home efficiency improvements, there are challenges to overcome. Indeed, our Parliament declared a housing emergency. Can the First Minister outline how his government approach to housing policy will help achieve the mission of eradicating child poverty?
First Minister.
President Officer, the points that Ruth Maguire raises are very important, and we have to ensure we have a sustainable investment programme in affordable housing. I set out in my statement the progress that we have made, and we are in a stronger position in terms of what we have delivered than any other part of the United Kingdom. But we face the acute challenges in the housing budget because of the reduction in capital budget and the very significant erosion of the financial transactions resources that would habitually have been used to fund housing expenditure. That's why the Housing Minister is exploring with the Housing Task Force, the Housing Investment Task Force, about expanding the sources of capital that are available to support our affordable housing programme. And the progress on that will be reported to Parliament as the Housing Minister takes forward those discussions.
Ash Regan, to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note the First Minister has set out that his stated priority, his number one priority, is eradicating child poverty. And I welcomed the announcement the government made in February on school meal debt, which the First Minister had spoken about again today. But it is just a temporary reprieve. We know that attainment, behaviour and attention of children in schools is much improved when they're not going hungry at school. So when will the government fulfil its promise on free school meals?
First Minister.
The Presiding Officer, Ash Regan makes an important point, and I recognise the significance of free school meals. We have an extensive amount of free school meal provision within the education system, and the government is looking at the resources that are available to us to determine at what stage we will be able to pursue any expansion of that programme. But I have to say to Parliament that, and I've been completely open about this point, we face very significant financial challenges because of the combination of austerity, Brexit and the effect of inflation on our financial resources available to us. And we will consider all of these issues as we formulate our budget proposals this year.
And Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was very moved to hear the First Minister speak of his wife's tirelessness in trying to make sure that multiple sclerosis does not get in the way of her living her life to the full. Growing up as a child of a deaf father, I was well aware of the struggles that come with living with additional support needs. With this in mind, can I ask the First Minister how the Scottish Government will ensure that those living with additional support needs in Scotland are supported in living their lives to the full?
First Minister.
President Officer, I'm very grateful to my colleague Karen Adam for her kind remarks, and she also, in her comment, makes the point about her own support for her father. I cannot miss the opportunity to commend the support that my wonderful son gives to his mother when his father is not on the scene, and even when his father is on the scene as well. So let me put that on the record today. The Government has a number of commitments to strengthen the support that's available to individuals with additional support needs. The commitments are delivered at an individual level. We are obviously we're mindful of the report that the Education Committee has recently published on additional support needs, and we will be considering the contents of the Education Committee report, because I recognise the evidence base that's been supplied there is of significance, and the Education Secretary will have more to say to Parliament about that in due course.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's statement. I will allow a moment for front benches to organise before we move on to the next item of business.